Over the years, the beautiful game has provided us with some memorable goals. We've searched through our back catalogue to compile our favourites from across the globe. So sit back and enjoy this collection of 500 great goals. At the tender age of 17, Pelé was the youngest player to take part in the 1958 World Cup tournament. The Brazilian sensation scored 6 goals in 4 matches, his first goal in the final, the pick of the bunch.
At the time, a lot of journalists wrote, God, Pelé's just a 17-year-old kid. Look at all the responsibility he has. How can he be feeling? And I thought, my God, in that national team, I really didn't have that much responsibility. That lay with the older players like Nilton Santos, Gigi, Bellini, those more experienced players. I was just living my dream. I didn't have any worries at all. And I just wanted to play. I had no responsibility at all.
Pelé hooked the ball over his head and followed up with a precise volley past helpless Swedish goalkeeper Kalle Svensson. Brazil were crowned world champions. Greek side Panathinaikos were torn apart by an on-fire Barcelona side eager to book their place in the knockout stage of the competition. In a team full of stars, Cameroon striker Samuel Eto'o managed to shine the brightest, scoring 3 goals to give the Catalans a 5-0 victory. Eto'o's third goal was this stunning shot, high over keeper Mario Galinovic. If you're going to score an incredible goal, why not do it on the big stage? Never a player to shirk the limelight, Hull City's Dean Windass rose to the big occasion as his team took their place in the Championship playoff final at Wembley. Fittingly, the local lad and cult hero scored the only goal of the match. This scorching volley booked Hull City's place in the top flight for the first time in their 104-year history.
It was a magic goal, because if you can hit it 100 times, you will never score it again.
Quite simply, one of the best goals ever scored in the history of the European Championships.
The goal I made was a long ball from Mircea. I was a little bit tired already. So when I had to stop the ball and then to dribble or making other things, I just gave it a try and it went out in a special way in the goal.
It was a little bit typical from Boston, because normally you cannot shoot from that distance and not from that angle, because it was very difficult. But he made the decision to shoot the center to the second post, and it was a great moment.
Seeing that magic goal from Boston was like, what is going on? It was like almost as like it had to happen. We had to win it for one reason or another. It was our destiny.
Italy only just made it through the group stages of the 1982 World Cup before beating Brazil on their way to the final. Facing West Germany at the Bernabeu in Madrid, they were already ahead midway through the second half when Marco Tardelli doubled their advantage before setting off on one of the most memorable goal celebrations ever. 20 minutes later, Italy became the second side to win the World Cup 3 times. Probably the most famous goal in Scottish football history and still celebrated to this day, Archie Gemmell's goal against the Netherlands in the 1978 World Cup was a seminal moment for young and old alike. An unlikely hero, the tenacious midfielder played a magnificent 1-2 with Kenny Dalglish and left the Dutch defence in his wake. A moment of glory for Gemmell and a nation. The late George Best spent 11 seasons at Manchester United and produced some of the greatest football of his career. A few seasons after leaving Old Trafford, he went to play in the NASL in the United States. Even in his mid-30s, his brilliance was still in evidence as he scored this fantastic goal for the San Jose Earthquakes in 1981. Only a few weeks out of his teens, Lionel Messi was already showing why some had hailed him as the best footballer of his generation. Already a Champions League winner with Barcelona and an established member of the Argentinian national side, this superb lob for his country against Mexico in the 2007 Copa America semi-final showed both speed of thought and a deft touch. A friendly between Brazil and Argentina is usually anything but that. Their clash in London at Arsenal's Emirates Stadium saw Brazil take control from the start. It was left to their star performer Kaká to put the icing on the cake. He ran half the length of the pitch, outpacing Lionel Messi in the process to seal his country's 3-0 win and gave the 60,000 crowd a moment to remember. World Cup holders France were hoping to add another title to their World Cup trophy in the final of the 2000 European Championships. At 1-1, the game went to a sudden-death golden goal scenario, and young David Trezeguet snatched the top prize with a brilliant left-foot strike.
The manager told me to try and give something extra to the team. And I had the chance to score. Of course, it was special for me because my family and my friends were there. But it was more special for my teammates because I felt we had a really strong team and the players wanted to go all the way. We tried, especially the players who played less, we tried to bring something to a team that was already very good. That was the strength of that team, and the result was we won the tournament.
Few footballers made as big an impact on English football as Ferenc Puskas. As captain of Hungary in 1953, his team came to Wembley and gave England a masterclass. Puskas was happy to take the leading role. His superb drag back and shot was one of six goals his side scored to demolish the inventors of the beautiful game. Kevin Keegan was at his peak in 1980, having just won his second successive European Footballer of the Year award. Nearing the end of his spell in Germany with Hamburg, Keegan was the first name on England manager Ron Greenwood's team sheet. This exquisite lob against the Republic of Ireland at Wembley showed why. Aston Villa were the second of five English clubs where Benito Carbone played. The Italian forward helped Villa reach the 2000 FA Cup final, scoring a hat-trick in the fifth round tie against Leeds. This fantastic long-range shot, the best of Carbone's treble, as Villa won 3-2. The Soviet Union were already 1-0 up 4 minutes into their group game with Hungary at the 1986 World Cup finals. Sergei Aleinikov decided to try his luck from outside the area and beat Hungarian goalkeeper Peter Dichtl to double the Soviets' advantage as they eased to a 6-0 win. Cultured centre-back Mark Lawrenson scored 18 goals for Liverpool in his 7 seasons with the club. This example against Southampton shows why the former Preston and Brighton man was such an asset for the Anfield side. Following an interception and great run off the ball, Lawrenson ran onto a Dalglish pass before slotting in low. At the time, Lawrenson was the most expensive defender in Britain, but he turned out to be a bargain. Fratton favourite Matthew Taylor opened the scoring against Everton with one of the goals of the season. Taylor, who began his career at Luton Town, had caught the eye of several Premier League managers, but chose to sign for First Division outfit Portsmouth. He helped them to promotion in the 2002-2003 season and signed a long-term contract in July 2006. The fans were thrilled, particularly when he scored goals of this calibre. Few players matched Milos Krasic's role in helping Serbia reach the 2010 World Cup finals. The Russian-based midfielder's composure and pace caused defenders all sorts of problems in the qualifying stages. This strike against Austria was the pick of the goals from Krasic and illustrates his innate talent. Any fears Arsenal fans may have had of a cup giant killing at Huish Park were quickly allayed by one man, Ian Wright. He bagged a hat-trick that day, but it was his second that even had the Yeovil fans applauding. Having claimed the number 8 shirt as his own, the ex-Crystal Palace striker had already scored 10 goals before Christmas, and he started the new year in the same vein. Pouncing on a defensive error, he spotted the keeper off his line and chipped into the net with perfection. Midfielder Raphael van der Vaart made his Ajax debut in 2000 at the tender age of 17. After 3 years with the club, he was a seasoned pro, and in November of 2003, he scored this incredible goal against arch-rivals Feyenoord. Ajax won the league at the end of the season, 6 points ahead of PSV Eindhoven, and van der Vaart was appointed captain the following season. Scotland came out all guns blazing at Seville's Estadio Benito Villamarín, David Neri opening the scoring on 18 minutes. But it wasn't long before Brazil had equalised with a trademark free kick from Zico. A perfectly struck ball snaking round the wall and dipping with impeccable timing past a dumbfounded Alan Ruff. The white Pelé was named one of the top 10 players of the tournament. Despite starting his career at Arsenal, David Bentley never made a home appearance in the Premier League for the Gunners. When he returned with their North London neighbours Tottenham in 2008, it took him just 13 minutes to show his former employers what they had missed. Bentley opening the scoring in spectacular fashion as his side shared the spoils in an 8-goal thriller. Thomas Brolin wasn't a name many in England were familiar with in 1992. The Parma striker, a seasoned performer in Serie A, soon changed that. Playing for his native Sweden at Euro 92, Brolin produced a magical touch and a sublime finish to help Sweden beat England and qualify for the semi-finals at their expense. In two seasons with Fiorentina, midfielder Mauro Bressan only made a handful of starts, but he wrote his name into club folklore in the 1999-2000 Champions League campaign with this spectacular overhead kick from distance. Opponents Barcelona could only gaze in wonder at Bressan's goal, which is still considered one of the greatest Champions League goals of all time. Another bicycle kick, this time from Preston North End's Patrick Aguimang. Aguimang had to be content with appearances from the bench in his first two seasons with Preston, but at the start of the 2006-07 campaign, he got his chance. Early on in the season, Aguimang scored a memorable winner against West Bromwich Albion with this impressive overhead bicycle kick, one to remember for the Preston fans. Norway hadn't qualified for the World Cup finals in over 50 years and weren't expected to make it to the USA in 1994. However, they beat the Netherlands and then, thanks to Kjetil Rekdal's 35-yard volley, drew with England at Wembley. Rekdal, who had only recently been recalled to the national side, represented Norway at both the 1994 and 1998 finals. Loved in equal measure in Florence and his native Argentina, Gabriel Batistuta took just 2 minutes to open his account on his World Cup debut in 1994. Playing against Greece in his country's opening match, Batistuta scored this fantastic goal during the course of a stunning hat-trick as Argentina won 4-0. Only 3 minutes had been played at the Commerzbank Arena before Michael Fink opened the scoring in spectacular style.
And here's Fink! Sensational volley gives Eintracht Frankfurt the lead inside 3 minutes. Magnificent technique. What a sweet strike.
No score at the end of 90 minutes in this fourth-round League Cup match. The Chelsea fans had waited patiently for the goals to come, and in extra time, they got a cracker. Arjen Robben, who had made his debut for the Blues earlier in the month, made the run past Andy O'Brien and Titus Bramble before sliding the ball in at the far post. His third goal in three games and a strike to savour, and Chelsea's two-goal win put them into the last eight of the competition. Portugal's final warm-up match before hosting the 2004 European Championships was against Lithuania. Felipe Scolari's team showed they were ready for the big occasion. Pauleta on form with a pick of Portugal's four goals. The Paris Saint-Germain player controlled from a long clearance from keeper Ricardo Oliveira to casually chip into the net from 30 yards.
All I was thinking was one has to go in, because I'd had like about 10 free kicks. I don't think I've had as many as that in a game, and I knew one had to go in.
We'd had so many free kicks today that I wanted one of them. You know, it seemed like if we didn't get that one, we would have had a couple more later on. And so I wanted the chance to have one go, and he wouldn't let me. Fair dues. You know, he's the man on the free kicks, and he come up trumps.
2-1 down, England needed a goal to qualify for the World Cup.
Beckham could raise the roof here with a goal. I don't believe it. David Beckham scores the goal to take England all the way to the World Cup finals. Give that man a knighthood.
It was up to our skipper to pull us out, and I thought he worked tirelessly all day and thoroughly deserved his goal.
Middlesbrough were already two goals to the good in this FA Cup semi-final replay at Hillsborough, but Brazilian Emerson wanted a piece of the action.
Went off by Ravanelli to Emerson. What a goal! That is a magnificent strike. Teed up by Fabrizio Ravanelli. And he hit it so sweetly. Emerson, the Brazilian, to make it 3-0.
Glenn Hoddle's most prolific goal-scoring season came in 1979-80, where it seemed almost everything came off. This particular goal not only demonstrated his perfect technique, but the ball never touched the ground from goalkeeper to it rocketing past Peter Shilton in the opposite goal. One of Chelsea's all-time favourite sons, Peter Osgood, never disappointed, especially in the FA Cup, where many of his most treasured moments remain. His goal here against Arsenal was the high point in an entertaining sixth-round tie that would end with the teams having to do it all over again at Highbury. Newly promoted Scunthorpe had a strong start to their championship season with three home wins and continued their winning ways on the road. Striker Paul Hayes flicking the ball over Adam Virgo's head before blasting it past keeper Dean Gherkin. A fine solo effort that was enough to seal the match. There have been many amazing headers over the years. Here are a few favourites, starting with England's Gary Lineker. In this match, he was playing with two odd boots. It didn't stop him from heading a goal. Benfica disposed of Naval with this Javi Garcia goal. Marcelo Salas right on target against Uruguay. Manari getting ahead of the game against Juve. And finally, Terry Mack heads home at Anfield. Brazilian left-back Silvinho joined Manchester City in August 2009. At the turn of the year, he scored his first goal in a 4-2 win against Championship side Scunthorpe in the FA Cup fourth round. The goal, the visitors' third, was a spectacular long-range strike. The great Maradona is credited by many with single-handedly turning the fortunes of Napoli around. In his third season with the club, they became the first southern team to win the Scudetto. Once again, Maradona undid the defence before taking a lightning-quick and pinpoint-accurate shot at goal. Maradona had returned from Mexico with a World Cup title, and the 86-87 season turned out to be Napoli's best ever as they achieved a League and Cup double. In the first round of the UEFA Cup, Inter beat Rapid Bucharest over two legs.
Here's Bergamy, the skipper. Inter looking to strike here. It's Bergkamp! How is that for a finish? Absolutely exquisite from Dennis Bergkamp, the Dutch international. He's caught it on the volley here. That is fantastic technique. Right into the corner.
Inter would go on to win the competition at the end of the season, beating Salzburg. Financial worries were put to one side, and the Eagles fans received a nice Valentine's Day present when Darren Ambrose gave Palace the lead in their fifth-round cup tie against Aston Villa. Palace were awarded a free kick after Stylian Petrov fouled Nick Carl. Up stepped Ambrose to smash home from 30 yards. Brad Friedel got a hand to it, but was unable to keep the ball out. Liverpool were 3-2 down in the dying minutes of the FA Cup final, but Steven Gerrard wasn't finished.
Atuesta tossed it towards Morientes, and then Gerrard! Oh! Oh, goodness me! What a strike! From Steve at Gerrard. I told you, don't write them off.
It was a strange goal, really, because, you know, when Paul Konchesky scored, I thought, you know, the game's over. I just thought we were just seeing out the clock. I was cramped up, I was really tired. And on another day, if I never had cramp, and the scoreline was different, I may have tried to control that ball and tried to set up an attack, but I just thought to myself that, you know, the clock's running out, time's running out, I'm just going to hit this as hard as I can and try and hit the target, and of course it's so nice.
It was an absolute pile driver from the man many feel is the best midfielder in the world.
The semi-final of the 2007 Asian Cup saw Saudi Arabia beat one of the favourites, Japan, by 3-2. Man of the match, Malik Maaz, scored 2 for the Saudis. His second was a beautifully executed move down the left. Running into the box, Maaz then snaked his way around the Japanese defence before beating the keeper at his near post. Maaz, voted Player of the Year by the Saudi Arabian Football Federation, celebrated in style. The Saudis had booked their place in the final. They would face Iraq in an all-Arab affair. Sammy Lee spent a decade at Anfield. He only scored 19 goals, but they were worth the wait. This goal came against Manchester City in the league. Liverpool awarded a free kick from 30 yards out, and Lee thumping the ball into the top corner. Sammy Lee worked tirelessly in midfield for his club, and his endeavour helped Liverpool to a 13th league title at the end of the season. An amazing encounter in this World Cup qualifying game. At 3-2 down, Venezuela were on a mission for victory, and incredibly, they scored 3 times in the last 10 minutes to take the points. At 3-all, the Bolivian keeper Carlos Edwin Arias had to go off injured. With all their substitutes on, left-back Luis Gutierrez was obliged to pull on the keeper's jersey. Up stepped Giancarlo Maldonado as the hero of the hour. He scored 1 to give Venezuela the lead, then in injury time spied an opportunity to lob the hapless Gutierrez. An incredible goal. Ayol Berkovic with the opening goal of the game in this fourth-round FA Cup tie.
Great strike! Oh, City have scored! And it's Berkovic! It's a wonderful strike.
Over to the San Siro for AC Milan against Juventus, and a brilliant volley on the edge of the area from Bianconeri striker Pierluigi Casiraghi. The match finished all square, but a special moment for the striker. Having made his debut on the opening day of the 2002-2003 season, the child prodigy that was Wayne Rooney saw his first goal arrive in the last minute against champions Arsenal to cement his place in Everton folklore. A few days short of his 17th birthday, the rising star illustrated what was in store as his career suddenly took off. That's all for now. See you next time for more great goals.